Welcome to our quarterly regular meeting of the Tennessee Board of Regents on this beautiful East Tennessee morning, Friday, September 26th. You're welcome. Fran and I had a chuckle about that as we left the hotel this morning. So, wow, what a wonderful way to start the day with Dr. Wise's presentation. The vibrancy, the energy, the caring that I know we've all felt here at Pellissippi State over the past 2 days is evident in force. We had a spectacular dinner last night thanks to the culinary arts students, a remarkable program. As Dr. Wise mentioned, the performance from the Variations Ensemble gave us all goosebumps. The arrangements were spectacular. So to the group, thank you for sharing your time and your talent with us. It really is all about one story at a time. And Dr. Wise, thank you for sharing Jesse's video with us. I was also reminded of as much as things change, they stay the same. The Vietnam veterans, Ralph Martin and Terry Sisk, who were featured, we fast forward to the incredible 40 years of history at this place, and we once again have a veteran center, which some of us saw yesterday, operating on this campus to serve those who continue to serve this country in such an admirable way. So to Pellissippi State, happy birthday, and we will continue to thank you throughout the course of this meeting, but for the spectacular hospitality we have experienced over the past 2 days. So our profound thanks, and keep up the good work for another 40 years. So well done, well done. Madam Secretary, would you call the roll?
Yes, ma'am. Regent Duckett. Regent Freeman.
Present.
Regent Griscom.
Here.
Commissioner Huffman. Commissioner Johnson.
Here.
Regent Markham.
Here.
Regent Prescott.
Here.
Regent Reeves.
Here.
Regent Reynolds.
Here. Sorry.
I apologize.
No, that's correct.
Regent Roddy.
Here.
Regent Shockey.
Here.
Regent Smith.
Here.
Regent Stites.
Here.
Regent Thomas.
Here.
Regent Varlin.
Here.
Regent Webb.
Here.
You have a quorum.
Thank you very much. We have a great program today, and we'll be talking about the Tennessee Promise in great depth, which is exciting. So I hope we have lots of discussion and dialogue. But before we get to that substantive piece of our program, we do have some business to take care of this morning. We have before us minutes from our June 20 quarterly meeting, the minutes from a specially called session that was held on the 15th of July. And I will entertain a motion to accept those minutes as presented to you.
So moved.
Second.
Second. We have a motion by Regent Thomas for approval, a second from Regent Varlin. Any discussion?
Yeah, ma'am, actually, because we did get a copy out, and I'm assuming that these minutes now reflect the changes. Thank you.
Thank you. So they are minutes as revised. Thank you very much, yes. Regent Griscom. Any further discussion? If not, I believe this just requires a voice vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you very much. Chancellor Morgan, we are ready for your interim action report.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I believe each of you have previously been provided a copy of the interim action report that really is a record of the business transactions that have transpired since our last regular quarterly meeting. Pending any questions about the matters contained in that report, I would recommend the board approve.
Thank you very much. I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second. Thank you, Regent Freeman. Second by Regent Griscom. Any further discussion? Hearing none, this also requires a voice vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. The ayes have it. Yesterday, we had a lot of committee work and a lot of good work by Sanja and Pat and the team in getting our minutes to us last night and the updates on our TBR app. We have on our consent agenda approval for the minutes from our TCAT committee yesterday, academic policies and programs, audit committee, and then from September 12, the ad hoc committee on committee meetings. I will entertain a motion to ratify those items on the consent agenda. Thank you, Regent Griscom. Second from Regent Roddy. Any discussion? Hearing none, this too is a voice vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you very much. The Regent's Award in Philanthropy. Regent Markham.
Sorry.
Oh, that's okay. This is always a great time to highlight folks who have been so generous to our system and our institutions. And we have a special one today.
Yes, thank you, Vice Chairman Reynolds. Today, the Tennessee Board of Regents is proud to recognize the recipient of the Regents Award for Excellence in Philanthropy. In April of 2013, this community learned the name Lars Eriksson, and many are still grappling with the unprecedented generosity he bestowed upon Austin Peay University. Mr. Eriksson is a Florida native and the owner of Crankshaft Rebuilders. His late wife, Martha, graduated from Austin Peay in 1962 with a Bachelor of Science in Education. Lars Eriksson presented Austin Peay University with the largest single gift in its history. in order to honor the legacy of his late wife, Martha Dickerson Erickson. Her name is now permanently affixed to one of the new state-of-the-art residence halls on the eastern edge of the campus and to the university's College of Education. In addition to the naming of the College of Education, the education students receiving these scholarships are known as Erickson Scholars, and the Martha Dickerson Erickson College of Education STEM Center was renamed Jack Hunt STEM Center in honor of Ms. Erickson's late brother-in-law. The Jack Hunt STEM Center allows prospective teachers to gain a familiarity with a variety of scientific equipment and technology, which will educate them how to successfully use this technology in their future classrooms. The center also offers continuing education seminars and workshops throughout the year for current classroom teachers in their STEM fields. Few of us knew the Erickson name before that April afternoon, but it will now be so woven into the fabric of this campus and public education in Tennessee that future generations of students will come to associate it with the generosity and academic excellence. Austin Peay is a stronger institution thanks to Mr. Erickson's generosity. It is with great pleasure to acknowledge Austin Peay State University's Excellence in Philanthropy Award to Mr. Lars Erickson. I would now like to ask Austin Peay President Alyssa White to make additional comments. And welcome to the board for her first time.
Thank you very much. The Erickson Gift honors the legacy of Martha Dickerson Erickson, and it equips STEM teachers with tools and knowledge to help them better serve their students. And since spring of 2013, the program has supported 14 students who are now serving as science and mathematics teachers after earning an undergraduate or graduate degree and teacher licensure. Another 17 students currently are working toward graduation, and we have 7 Erickson Mathematics Graduate Fellows who are current mathematics teachers, and they're completing a rigorous program that will qualify them to become mathematics leaders and master teachers. We have served in the STEM Center since the Jack Hunt STEM Center was renamed. We have served approximately 360 pre-service teachers, 253 in-service teachers, and more than 955 K-12 students. And we're very thankful to have received this gift, and we're proud that Mr. Lars Erickson has been awarded the prestigious Regents Award for Excellence in Philanthropy. Thank you.
Thank you, President White. Vice Chair, this concludes my report.
Thank you very much. What a wonderful example of generosity and commitment to Austin Peay. It's very exciting. And several of us were at a dinner a few months ago honoring Mr. Erickson and the ribbon cutting at the facility. So that was very exciting. So it's a great example, and you never know, right, what thoughts may trigger in others when they see folks like the Erickson. So thank you, Regent Markham. And thank you, Dr. White, and welcome again. Now it's time for our Chancellor's Report and our Tennessee Promise update and discussion.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I think you will find this to be a very interesting discussion. Before we get to the first of our speakers, I would like just to take a minute and recognize once again our Maxine Smith Fellows who are here with us today. And this won't take but just a minute, but I think this will be interesting for you, for board members, and for those in the audience. And I'd like to just name the fellows and tell you the project that they worked on. Ms. Keisha Caldwell from Chattanooga State Community College, her project was creating a consistent TBR Community College admissions requirement plan. Mr. Patrick Davis from Jackson State, the impact of mobile technology on teaching and learning in the undergraduate population. Dr. Cheryl Green from Tennessee State, Connect 25, non-traditional student engagement at public TBR universities. Where are we and where do we need to go? Dr. Melissa Irvin, from Tennessee Tech, Greater Than the Sum of Its Parts: How to Effectively Use System-Level Data Warehousing in Higher Education. Dr. Jasmine Renner from East Tennessee State University, Engaging Tennessee Board of Regents Faculty in Online Research Communities and Emerging Technologies. Ms. Dana Smethers, Innovate, Create, Execute: An Entrepreneurial Mindset in Higher Education. Dr. Kim Sequoia from Middle Tennessee State University, Measuring Quality in Graduate Education: A Balanced Scorecard Approach. Dr. Michael Torrance from Vol State, Veteran Support: Accessing Educational Resources. Ms. Yolanda Williams from the TCAT here in Knoxville, Seeking to Serve More: An Analysis of Capacity to Meet Students and Industry Demands. And last but not least, Dr. Jeffrey Wilson from Memphis, University of Memphis. Project was Maximizing Impact: Purposefully Incorporating Diversity Efforts Within Post-Secondary System-Wide and Institutional Strategic Plans. Please join me in congratulating them. And those presentations will soon be available sometime later next month. Will be available on the website, and I would encourage you to go out and take a look at them, because they're really extraordinarily high quality work. And now, Madam Chair, in keeping with my tradition of pushing my report off on other people, it's worked so far. I would like to recognize and invite to the podium Mike Krause. Mike Krause, besides being a good friend of mine for now several years, currently serves as the executive director of the Drive to 55 and Tennessee Promise. Prior to that, he was assistant executive director for academic affairs at TEHEC. Prior to that, Mike served as a policy analyst for several years for the Tennessee General Assembly. Before joining state government, he served for 8 years in the U.S. Army and the Tennessee Army National Guard, completed 3 combat tours as a member of the 101st Airborne Division, and was awarded the Bronze Star during Operation Iraqi Freedom. Mike is committed to the work he does. We are blessed as a state to have him, and the role that he is now assumed, I think, has tremendous potential for changing the state of Tennessee. Mike Krause.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Chancellor. I appreciate that. And thank you to Vice Chair Reynolds for the opportunity to speak to you all. We are at a pretty pivotal juncture, both in the state's higher education and economic future, and specifically for the implementation of the Tennessee Promise. And so I wanted to bring an update to you all on where we stand right now. As it turns out, 3 combat tours is the perfect preparation to launch this program. It was exactly what I needed. But I want to show you just a real quick data point. And when we look at this data, which has a very sensitive mouse button connected to it. So these are all 50 states plotted as a function of their higher education attainment. And when we go and we talk to communities about Tennessee Promise, one of the things we're most frequently asked, and I think it's a great question, is why did the governor come to this conclusion that we needed to do this? And I like to show this data to say, you know, Governor Haslam launched the Tennessee Promise because we don't have a choice. We had to do something radical. Because when you look at all 50 states and you see Tennessee on the right end of the continuum highlighted in red, that's pretty disturbing. What's more disturbing is the near perfect correlation between this data and other data, like incarceration rates and public health crises and wage earnings, certainly. And so when we saw this data a few years ago, it was the catalyst for the Drive to 55. And a component of the Drive to 55, and at this point, one of the more significant components is the Tennessee Promise. Want to walk through really quickly a couple different points, and I do want to review the program itself, because I always think it's helpful for us to start with what are we talking about, because the Tennessee Promise has, to some extent, become a blank canvas upon which people are painting some of their beliefs that may not be entirely accurate. I want to say the most significant thing, though, is the big picture, and that is that the Tennessee Promise is aiming to change our culture. It's aiming to change the trajectory of students. And though right now we're spending a lot of time talking to seniors, ultimately this becomes about fifth graders and ninth graders and breathing into students something about their destiny. And it is an intensely human program. This is focused on kids and families getting jobs and having better lives. The best quote I've heard lately was given, I was up in Greenville yesterday. I will tell you, I have traveled this state far and wide. I've learned where every Chick-fil-A in Tennessee is, and I can share that with you if it's helpful. But the director of the Greene County Schools gave the best possible summation. She was talking to her school board last night, and she said, you know, the best thing the Tennessee Promise has created is renewed interest and excitement from many of our students who never before thought college would be an option. And that is what we're trying to do. The way we're trying to do it is through a kind of a multi-component program. Everybody knows, I think at this point, the tuition-free concept behind Tennessee Promise. And that is a concept that was pioneered here in Knoxville. I would be remiss to not mention that. That Tennessee Achieves laid the foundation for us to be able to do this as a state. The Tennessee Achieves Executive Director, Chrissy D'Alejandro, is here, and we'll talk a little bit more about her organization in a moment. But the concept is bring to the table three different financial aid components. First, lottery, then Pell, then TSAA. After those three components, if you have remaining financial need towards tuition and mandatory fees, we will cover that. We also think that that tuition assistance, though, is really not effective if you just throw money at the problem. That there's a mentorship component here that I think is the single most important part. Giving first-generation college students financial aid without guidance is not a solution. But putting them in a structure of mentorship where they have someone from their community who serves as Chrissy likes to call it, the reminder in chief. Hey, you need to register. Hey, have you done your FAFSA? We think, and the data tells us, that's a very effective approach for first-generation college students. We're also going to put on a layer of training. In the spring, they're going to have to go to two meetings. Those meetings are really important. And those meetings are where we level the playing field for a first-generation college student. Those of us that were fortunate to have parents that went to college, we knew what college should look like because you could ask mom and dad. First-generation college students, they don't have that reference point. They learn this coming spring what college should look like. And we hope that that reduces their anxiety level. And when they go onto campus, remember, in every first-generation college student's head is a constant conversation about whether or not they can do this. And it really lasts through the first semester of college. We are trying to give another voice in that conversation. That is, I can do this. I've been on a college campus before. We're going to ask them to do three things. First, 8 hours of community service per semester. We think that's a very reasonable request that teaches students an intangible lesson about giving back to your community if the state is making an investment in you. And there's a selfish request there too, and that is that the SESE data is very clear that students that perform community service succeed at much higher rates than those that don't. We're going to ask them to maintain academic progress, which really is not a function of a Tennessee Promise policy as much as it is each of our institutions. You have to maintain SAP in order to stay enrolled, so we're going to ask them to do that. And we're going to ask them to go full-time, because the data is clear. Full-time students, our community colleges do a fantastic job of graduating full-time students. And I get very personally offended when people say, well, why are we sending them to community colleges? I'll tell you why. Because when you go full-time at a community college, you have a 65% graduation rate in Tennessee. That's a remarkable comment about our presidents in the audience and what they do when a student plugs in. It's really hard to help a student that's dabbling. And we're going to ask that students don't dabble. We're also going to ask that they enroll immediately following graduation. There'll be no backpacking through Spain in the Tennessee Promise. We're going to ask that you maintain your momentum. And again, we think that's a fair request. We really started, so I started this role June 2nd. The governor had called me about 2 weeks before and asked if I'd be willing to do this. Obviously, it is the opportunity if you're a higher education wonk like I am. This is the dream of your career that you could be involved with this. We started with the theory, though, that a state financial aid program is always destined to just be a state financial aid program, unless you build some concentric rings of support across the state. And so we spent our first few months, and indeed we're kind of still in this phase, on the road. We started with a really important group, many of whom are in the audience, and that is our presidents and our TCAT directors. Our goal was to talk to them about how this looks on their campus, and it's not going to look the same at Pellissippi as it does at Dyersburg. Well, as you would have guessed, all 13 of those community college presidents already had their plans. It was kind of me learning what they were already going to do. And their success has been the student success. We engaged another group that isn't often seen in this discussion, and I think it has paid tremendous dividends, our county mayors. County mayors occupy a really unique place. They deal with K-12 issues via the budget, but then they also deal with workforce development issues. And in their workforce development conversations, they spend a lot of time being frustrated. And so we wanted to engage them and have them at this table to say, this is not a higher education initiative. We want you here to make this a jobs initiative. K-12 district leaders, we thought it was key that all of our superintendents understood this program. And then to that end, drawing on my military background, the guidance counselors are really the infantry in this battle. We trained, we held 17 guidance counselor trainings across the state that concluded just last week. We did 2,963 miles in 3 weeks. Those guidance counselors are remarkable. We hope to equip them to be able to talk about the Tennessee Promise in a very accurate way. And I think that the response we received kind of indicated they were ready. When we issued the invitation from the governor, in 24 hours we had 600 RSVPs, in 48 hours we had 900, and at the end of the day we trained 1,135 guidance counselors. There's only 1,300 in the state. So we came very close to having, I think, the deepest possible market penetration you could have. Regent Freeman, did you have a question?
You just answered it.
Great. Thank you. I employ psychic communication throughout this presentation.
Very good. I have 10 more questions. Yeah. What are they?
And this is the most important thing, and that was making sure students and parents understood this program. Every single senior in this state has received a direct communication from the governor's office that was distributed from their guidance counselor. These community college and TCAT leaders have been doing multiple events in their community. I really wish I'd thought to put this in the slideshow, but Dr. Apple from Motlow. So last Saturday was Scholarship Saturday. Many of you have seen this picture. And that morning, it looked like waiting to get into a Justin Bieber concert.
Wow.
And there were students wrapped around her building waiting to get in to apply for the Tennessee Promise. And I just thought it was a remarkable illustration. So here's where we are. As of this morning, we have 22,841 applicants. That's...
Question?
Yes.
What's the possibility?
Come again?
What's the possibility? If it's 22,000 applicants, how many could there have been?
That's a great question. Well, the good news is...
You already knew that question.
I saved that one for you to bring. So we're within this window right now, and if you'll look at this trajectory, obviously we open on August 15th, and November 1st is the deadline. The possibility is, within our group of seniors, there are 62,000 seniors in Tennessee, certainly a group of them are going to a four-year institution, and they don't need to apply for the Tennessee Promise. They need to go ahead and persist and go to their four-year school. We're really focused on two groups of students. The first group is the student that has perhaps applied to a four-year university, and they think they're going to go there. For whatever reason, we find that they aren't ultimately admitted to the four-year institution. That student needs to complete this application. And we try to be very clear to guidance counselors, and they know their students. The student that's in the middle, and we hope they get into that four-year institution. But if they don't, they need to have this safety net, because one of my messages to you today is if they apply for Tennessee Promise on November 2nd, they're not going to get the Tennessee Promise. This is the first rung of helping these students grasp a little personal responsibility. I am certain there will be students that, for whatever reason, come to us after the deadline. And that's going to be a very hard conversation. But given the broad communication efforts we've made, we feel confident that people know about November 1st and need to apply by November 1st. The other group of students that are most important to apply are the students who weren't thinking about higher ed. So in Tennessee, 59% of students go to college, 41% don't. This is a program for the 41%. And so the possibility, I think, Regent Freeman, is that I think we'll probably reach 30,000 applications, if not a little bit over that. What the attrition rate, so let's look at the rest of this continuum. And you'll see they'll need to complete their FAFSA by February 15th. They'll need to attend those two trainings I discussed. If they don't do one of those things, they don't receive the Tennessee Promise. These are crucial junctures for these students. And the data tells us there will be students that don't accomplish these tasks. And so because of that, I think that we could probably see maybe a 50% of the total applicant pool actually go on to a campus next fall, if that answers your question.
So I can ask as many questions as I like.
We want a discussion. Great.
August 15th, the Tennessee portal opens.
Yes.
What about those folks who live in households or apartments or projects that don't have access to the internet?
Two solutions to that. First, our community colleges and our K-12 campuses have tried to ensure that there is time embedded within the school day to do the application at a computer lab. But in the furthest extremity, we have a paper application that has been specifically requested, in fact, in some parts in Shelby County if they need it, specifically requested by Davidson County, specifically requested by rural counties as well. It's a similar, I think, similar issue in different settings. So we don't like paper applications. We think the online application is the best way. And I will tell you, thus far, we have not had any formal requests to bring in the paper app. The urban schools as well as the rural schools have tried to be very clear. Do your application during homeroom, do it at lunch, do it at night. We go, my staff and I, both of us, we go to schools at night when we are requested. And we sit there with iPads and we do the application on the spot. And a great juncture to talk about the application.
Yeah.
It's 10 questions. It's your name, your address, your social. We ask, because our community college presidents and TCAT directors requested it, for them to give us an indication of where they think they might go. And we send that data to the community colleges every week and the TCATs so they can work those students as prospects. The application's very simple. It takes 4 minutes on average. We've looked at the average.
So, Mike, for that 40%+ that you say really is not interested, what is your appeal to them to get them to really sit down seriously thinking about continuing education?
I think the biggest thing we have found with that audience, Regent Griscom, is that those students, one, could have attended college for free all along. A full Pell Award's $5,600, which obviously covers the cost of any community college in the state. A lot of them have taken themselves off the table. So when you talk to the 40%, you find it's not that they weren't interested. It's that at some point, they or their parents have shrugged and said, I can't afford college. And so what we have found with that 40% is it's less about having to convince them they need to go to higher ed. They know they need to go to higher ed. But convincing them this is now the vehicle that will enable them to.
So I'm going to pick up on this. We've had this conversation before. We tend to allow the message out there to be what the total amount that you would have to pay if you were full freight.
Right.
Rather than sitting down and sharing the information that says, this is why you can go, because you know, all things being equal, if you don't get anything, this is the number, but we know how many people really aren't in there. So you've made a good mess. We've got to continue thinking about how to communicate what the real cost in Tennessee is for higher education.
I completely agree. Because again, many of these students could attend for free,
right,
tuition free now. But they didn't get themselves to that FAFSA to find that out. And our message, the most powerful message, is the governor. And when he says during the State of the State, every high school graduate can attend a community or technical college tuition free, that's the catalyst that we have seen move that 40%.
Of the 22,000 applicants, do you have any idea what percentage of those were in the 40%?
We don't, and so that's an inexact science. We'll know, I think, by spring when we see what their actual application propensity is, but right now we don't know. Our estimates, though, and of course we've modeled this, we actually used economists at the UT Center for Business and Economic Research to help us model this. They estimate that out of a given cohort, One-third probably would have never entered college without the Tennessee Promise. The other two-thirds maybe would have gone to a community college but had significant financial need that may have been unmet. So if you think about, let's say next fall we end up with 15,000 students going onto a campus. UT tells us, and Bill Fox, who's the head economist there, was the one that did this. Dr. Fox tells us out of that 15,000 student cohort, 5,000 are unique entrants that would not have entered higher education otherwise. Now that's significant in a community college freshman class that's 17,000 students statewide. We have great confidence in those estimates as well because we did have Tennessee achieve 6 years of data to draw on to make those, but they are estimates.
Thank you.
We needed some parameters on the front end, and that's what we've had. Next August, I think you see where the trajectory ends. We become the only state in the nation where you can tell every high school student, every fifth grader, every kindergartner, you're going to community or technical college. And in fact, if you leave with just a high school diploma, you've dropped out. In Tennessee, we have a different continuum than every state in the nation. I always like to end with where we are metrics-wise. I'm metrics-driven. So our goal between now and November 1st was to reach 20,000 students. We've reached that now. Our new goal is to ensure that that's not 20,000 students represented by 30 of 95 counties. We're really ensuring that there is parity across counties and that in every county, students at least had the opportunity. And so we have gone through the data with a fine-tooth comb. We know who our 20 counties are, where the message appears to have not taken root, and we are personally visiting those counties and setting up events with their students. And here's the next part of our challenge. The Tennessee Promise, as I mentioned, is not just a financial aid program, and the mentorship component is key. And where we are statewide on that right now is we're right at 50%. I'll tell you the last 50% could be the most challenging. And Chancellor, if you will allow an indulgence, I would like to ask Chrissy to come up and discuss that. And actually, we're going to lock the doors, and the mentorship recruitment form will come around to each of you. But.
Good morning. Mike knows how to put a girl on the spot. So thank you so much for having us this morning and being able to share the story of Tennessee Promise. Yes, so Tennessee Achieves will be the partnering organization serving students in 84 of 95 counties across the state. We have been charged with recruiting and training 6,000 volunteers to begin working with these students in January. Exciting times. This morning I checked, we have 3,800, so we are a bit more than 50%. We have been, as Mike said, visiting every community, telling the story. If someone will open their door, we are sort of pushing it down and trying to talk through what it is to be a mentor with Tennessee Achieves. So what it is essentially is a 1 hour commitment. This is not Big Brothers Big Sisters, amazing organization, but mentoring for Tennessee Achieves, Tennessee Promise is simply what I think they play three roles. Number one, to be that cheerleader, to be that encourager. If no one in your family has ever been to college before, you need someone to say, we can do this, let's do this together. Number two, to be a taskmaster. I don't know how many of you know 17-year-olds, but I currently know about 15,000. They're just not on their game. They're not doing what they need to be doing. And so, as Mike said, it's really a program of harassment in many ways. Have you filed your FAFSA? Have you filed your FAFSA? When are you filing your FAFSA? So really being that taskmaster. And third, and what I think is very important to this conversation, is to be a resource. Going back to that first generation and really the student that Tennessee Promise seeks to target, it really is about, what's a semester? I had a student in the first year, and this really spoke to me, who asked me where on Pellissippi's campus he could find the building MWF. He was looking everywhere for MWF, right? So that's Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Dalton, when you need to be in class. So it is about being that resource. So for us, it's about sharing that this is a very small time commitment, but has the potential to make all the difference in a student pursuing and ultimately completing some type of post-secondary credential. So I appreciate the opportunity. We're thrilled. We're so excited watching the numbers come in. I'm certain we'll hit 30,000 applications, if not exceed. So the mentor need is quite great. Do you have questions for me about mentors?
I have one.
Sure.
In Putnam County, they've been going out to the industries and doing some work there. Instead of having parent-teacher meetings at school, they've basically been having them in the industries. And that has received a great deal of support and success. And it would seem to me that'd be a great place to get some of the mentors you're talking about. Have you all thought about that, or is there any effort toward that end?
Absolutely. So currently, 47% of our mentors do come from business and industry, chambers of commerce. So we really want to create a culture of bringing outsiders into the school. This really isn't about teachers mentoring. It's about someone from outside coming in and helping those teachers mentor the students and guiding them through not only that second semester of high school of their senior year, but also about that all important critical first semester of college. So Tennessee Promise has been very splashy about access, but I think the most important piece of this is completion. So for us, it's about making sure that the mentor follows the student into post-secondary. So it is very much a business-driven business for us. Great
Thank
comment.
You.
Thank you. Mike, thank you so much.
Thank you for your time. I always like to end on this note. And I think we'll do questions here in just a second. I don't know where we are on time, Ms. Reynolds, but
we're good.
Okay.
This is important.
I like to end here because this is what the governor said last year during the State of the State. And the single biggest misconception we get from the community and from campus, and I say this as a higher education person, this is not a higher education initiative. This is a jobs program. This is an opportunity to change fundamentally the way we talk to prospective employers who might be thinking of traveling to Tennessee.
Exactly right.
And I think that's the most important thing that can be said. And that's where the governor has tried to keep us focused throughout this process. Questions?
Reach Freeman.
I'll get my questions in later.
Okay. I'll ask you a question.
Yes, sir.
If this is Drive to 55, I understood the Drive to 55 was to try to get 55% of all graduates of high school to enter secondary education, right, or higher education. Is that not it?
No. 55% actually attain. So it's the difference between,
of some sort.
A credential,
okay.
Beyond high school.
All right, so then the 59% that we have that going to school doesn't apply because that is just the people who start,
That's exactly right.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, so the gap typically, if you look at a given county, the difference between their college going rate and their attainment rate ranges somewhere between 20 and 30%. And so, for instance, yesterday in Hamblin County, I think their college going rate was near 50%. Their attainment rate was more like low 30s. And that's a pretty typical gap you see in most counties. And it's a great point. Our business here is not the input. Our business is absolutely the attainment and output.
Mike, how do you get in front of those populations, like the Hispanic population, and make sure that they're aware of this program? And how do you get into those different communities to make sure that when we get these kids in school, we have the diversity that represents our state?
Absolutely. Well, I'll tell you, the first thing we do is and Chrissy made this point, we go anywhere we are asked, but we have tried to be very intentional. The fact is we don't reach this goal without success in Nashville and Memphis. And Davidson and Shelby County have enough students that if we succeed in those two counties, actually as a state, we are able to move the needle very quickly. We have tried to drill down, and as you would imagine, in both of those counties, there's significant diversity. And I'm glad you mentioned the Hispanic student population, which is really burgeoning in both of those areas. We go to schools, physically go to schools. We talk to students. We have, and really through TEHEC, we have the Latino Success Initiative in Memphis that's funded that is kind of hooked on to Tennessee Promise and delivering through that vehicle this message. We do not have bilingual products yet. I will be honest, we had a long conversation in Hamblin County about that yesterday because it is a need. Many of these students are fully eligible for Tennessee Promise. but English is still not their primary language, and I'm actually waiting to hear back. If we think there's significant enough need, we're certainly happy to produce those products.
You know, in Nashville Metro Schools, I think there are 80 different languages spoken. And, I mean, those people, they're your customers, your potential customers, and you've got to figure out a way to reach them. Also, 70% of the student population in Metro Schools, they're on free and reduced lunch.
Absolutely.
You've got to find a way to reach those individuals, or we're not going to be successful.
Completely agree. And I'll be speaking at Maplewood High School, in fact, on Thursday. Yesterday, I spoke at the Nashville Interfaith Ministers meeting. We're going to churches, by the way. We think that is a key component. And a lot of my Sundays are booked in the upcoming weeks. But I think that's an important group to talk about, because the churches, especially in Nashville, take very seriously their commitment to those students, far outside the sphere of just spiritual needs.
Cool. Is this timeline that you're using for this first class, is that going to be the timeline going forward, or will you make adjustments? The reason I'm asking is if you sit down and say, okay, just get used to this, because you're going to have to hit all these same dates regardless of when you come in. Is that a fair way to look at
this? It's a very fair way to look at this. And this continuum, again, really represents the work Tennessee Achieves and their calendar has looked like now for 6 years.
Okay.
So we want this to become ingrained in people's psyche, and specifically guidance counselors and students. You do your application by November 1st, you do your FAFSA, you go to your trainings, you do your community service.
Mike, excuse me. Did I understand you say that your staff is one?
Yes, sir.
So when you say we, is that two of you?
And she's part-time.
Yeah.
But it sounds a lot better than I. No, let me.
Can you do that? Can you accomplish this with two people?
I can.
When I'm part-time?
I absolutely can, and here's why. One, we are not the only ones. When I say we, I'm referring to Chrissy's team, who are a seamless part. I think we work hand in glove. I'm referring to the THEC and TSAC outreach staff, who have taken this up as their mission as well.
Okay.
And I'm referring, honestly, to the community colleges and TCATs. They don't need me to carry the message. In fact, I'm probably not the best messenger in some areas. We tend to go in when we see, one, a data indication that that county is lagging or at the request of a local leader. The actual organic governor's office Drive to 55 Tennessee Promise team is myself and Ann Buckle. But I think our partners provide the reach we need. I'm very confident.
So you think that what has held the TCATs and the colleges now from achieving this goal before you were brought in was just the money?
I do.
Okay.
I think that a first-generation college student getting $3,500 in financial aid is meaningless if there's a $500 gap, because they look at that $500 and it actually – it keeps them out of higher ed. And what we've seen, again, through the Tennessee Achieves experience, is if you can fill that gap, whether it's $100 or $2,000, they'll come. And that 41%, a large component of them, were just staying out because they were daunted by the costs.
Okay. Thank you, Vice Chancellor.
Thank you.
Mike,
I'm sorry. Regent Freeman. Regent Reeves has been waiting patiently, if you don't mind.
No, beauty first.
I had a question about the mentorships. How does someone go about signing up to do that? And do you?
I did not plant this question, by the way. I want to be clear.
And do you require specific qualifications to do that?
Sure. One, today when you sign up to be mentors, you will go to tnachieves.org or tnpromise.gov. You can apply via either portal. The application really is a function of one of our requirements, and that is we will obtain a state background check on every applicant for all the right reasons. We require you to be 21 years old. We require Chrissy, other, that's about it. Yeah, attend the trainings. So that's another thing, too. We don't just throw mentors in the deep end of the pool. They attend a state training where they learn this timeline, and we kind of equip them with best practices. Those are the requirements. One of the things I get asked a lot is, do you have to be a college graduate? I will tell you, and like Regent Stites, I'm from Putnam County. I'm from a very rural end of Putnam County, not the big city of Cookeville. I'm from Allgood. And I will tell you, there will be non-college graduates that want to mentor. I think they're fantastic mentors. I think who better to carry the message of how important it is to go to college than somebody who maybe feels like they missed their opportunity. So that's not a requirement, not a requirement. And we think that's a great demographic for us to enlist.
See, she had a great question. Now for the, is it my turn?
You may go, and then I'm going to read the Prescott.
Go ahead, Regent Prescott.
Are you sure?
Sure, pause.
Thank you. I had actually one question and one comment. First comment is, and I'm probably not the only one on this table, but I have served as a mentor for Tennessee Achieves, and it's very doable. It just like Mike says, it takes not very much time, but you make a real impact because these students do have questions that you can't believe they have. They're usually very simple to answer. So I think that's one thing we can do is encourage people to mentor, and our spheres of influence is important. You mentioned, Mike, that you can't reach your goal without Nashville and Memphis. Is it appropriate to ask you how you're doing in Nashville and Memphis?
Absolutely. Okay. I think we're doing very well in Shelby County right now. In Shelby County, I want to say we're at 30% of the senior class has applied, if not very close to that number. Brad Leon from Dorsey Hobson's office and I are in daily communication. Okay. Davidson County is doing well. They have a strategy that I'll be very frank about. We're in a little tension over. They intend to sign up 100% of their seniors. I don't think seniors at Hume Fog need to do this application. I think that they are probably on a different trajectory. But I am confident Davidson will do fine. Shelby County has been so gratifying, and it goes to Regent Freeman's question versus us going in and saying we're from the government here to help, which we are, and but
I didn't say that.
Yeah. But what we have done though to succeed in Memphis is to go to people like Dr. Prescott, and as you know, we have gone to Dr. Prescott and said, how do we succeed here in Memphis? And I think you and your partners have given us the template to succeed. We've relied on a locally driven strategy.
So Mike, I'm going to put my business hat on here for a second. So each high school, there's an opportunity, right?
Exactly.
What if you had a list of each high school and the percentage of their seniors that are signed up for this program, and then those of us who saw that list could say, hey, Pearl Cone, or hey, whatever, ABC school, we see you at 40%. You can do better. Kind of create some competition and some, and for us to know who's doing a great job.
We have that list.
Oh, awesome.
We don't have it by school, we have it by county. But if there are specific schools, and that is a function of our data system, which is cumbersome, but we can pull high schools when we need to and when they're requested, we do. Shelby County gets a by-school report every Tuesday. And they do exactly what you just mentioned, but I am happy to distribute that list to any region that requests.
But I would like to know, as a person that lives in Nashville, I would like to know what high schools in Nashville, where they stand on that list.
I can send you.
I could make a call and say, hey, ABC school, here's scholarship money. You've only signed up 30% of your kids.
I can send you that list.
Yeah,
I like that. Pearl Cone, they need to sign up 100% of their students. Maplewood needs to sign up 100% of their students.
Where are they?
They're not at 100%.
Okay.
And I'll send you the list.
But
Regent Chockey, did you have a question?
Or a comment? Answered it.
Oh, okay. Okay. Thank you.
Have we missed anybody here?
Thank you, Chancellor. Thank you, Ms.
Good job.
Oh, well done.
Thank you very, very much, Mark.
Cool.
A great conversation.
That's a good conversation.
And just for the board's information, I think sometimes we currently have about 30 mentors at the system office at this point. I think we'll have a few more by the time we have our training. There will be a training at the TVR office on October 16th, I believe is correct. So any of you who want to sign up and are convenient to come by the office, you can take your training with us. Next, I'd like to call Wendy Thompson to the podium to give us an update on the activities of the completion delivery unit. And then she will in turn, I think, introduce Tristan Denley, who will help with the help of others, will demonstrate some of the work that we have been doing.
Correct. Wendy. Thank you. Chancellor Morgan is my mentor, and so I in turn turn the microphone over to other people.
There you go.
So, good morning. We have three items for you. As we try to do each quarter, We're going to highlight one of our priority completion strategies. And as we do each September, we're going to give you a report on where we stand relative to our annual completion targets and our overall 2025 goal. And then we're going to preview a bit of our newly developed completion website. Again, in terms of our completion agenda, we know what we're trying to do. We know that we will award at least 43,202 credentials in 2025. We also know that we'll try to do this through developing and implementing priority strategies. And at this point in time, we have identified 10 priority strategies. And today we're going to highlight our data-driven decision-making strategy. So each strategy has a specific goal or aspiration, and the aspiration for this particular strategy is the next slide.
Yeah.
Okay. That is the formal strategy, but basically and primarily the aspiration or the goal for this strategy is to make sure that the right people have the right information in reasonably real time in order to inform decision making. Each priority strategy has a strategy leader and a strategy team that keeps track of the progress toward the strategy's goal. This particular strategy has a lot of moving parts. There are a lot of people in the system office and throughout the system that who are working together to make sure the strategy is successfully built and successfully implemented. There is also dedicated funding, a funding source for this particular strategy for the implementation and operation of it. At this time, we're going to demonstrate potential capabilities of the system we're building. I'm going to turn that portion over to Dr. Denley. And then following that demonstration, Catherine Middlebrooks, who's the assessment coordinator for the CDU, is going to give you the information related to our annual report on credentials awarded and progress towards our 2025 goal.
Can I ask you one question before
yes.
you step down? I think it's great that we're tracking a total number, but are we also tracking once you get that credential, what are you able to do with it? My concern is that we've got a lot of pushback that says, well, maybe you really don't need anything other than a high school degree. So I hope we're also, as you're putting this together, mm-hmm. showing that we're hitting this number, but now here's the result of having received this, you know, credential, that you are able to then take the next step and actually apply it and get a job or an improvement. So I haven't seen that any place, but I hope that that's part of what we're looking at.
We can make that a part of this. To date, this has been tracking the progress toward our compliance with the regulations, right. But we can certainly add that piece.
Wendy, could you go back to the previous slide? Do I need to get permission to ask a question?
Thank you. Go ahead.
Go back with the numbers. It has a chart. Yeah, that.
The trajectory.
Yes. So 43,000 by 2024.
In 2025.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Say it again.
In 2025. We'll award that many in that year.
What's the opportunity?
It depends. I'm a lawyer, so that's always my first answer. It depends on variables like enrollment. We're projecting out to 2025, so
yes.
There are some things we can project, some things we can't.
So let me go back. Well, I'll tell you what. Let's go back to 2013, 2014, where it's 30,756. What was the opportunity? What could we have done?
We have that data. I don't know that number. We can
okay.
get it for you. This is simply the number who graduated, the number from the senior class who graduated in that time period. So we can get you that information.
And if I could, maybe to give you a little background on where 43,202 comes from. and this really goes back to the public agenda that TEHEC adopted it as a result of and as part of the Tennessee Complete College Act passing. The goal of the public agenda was to move Tennessee's education attainment level to mirror the national average. We're quite a bit lower than the national average
okay.
now, and this would take us to the national average. And as TEHAC did that, they assigned expectations to various sectors, including our system, the University of Tennessee system, the private, the not-for-profit education sector, as well as proprietary. There was an expectation of the contribution that proprietary institutions would contribute. So 43202, as modified to reflect the work of our TCATs that really weren't part of the the TEHAC's work at that time, will be in the next iteration. That became our share of the responsibility, that if the state was going to get to where it needed to be, this is what we needed to contribute to that goal. Now, the universe, the possibilities, is, you know, I guess on in one respect, you would say that our possibility is for every student that's enrolled at each of our institutions to achieve their credential within some reasonable amount of time. So you can kind of look at our enrollment numbers and get a sense of what the, mm-hmm. the possibility would be if we were 100% efficient. We're not. We're working toward that. Everybody is committed to trying to move as fast and as quickly as we can to try to become more effective, more efficient, improve our completion rates, our graduation rates, and so forth. So the possibility is huge. I mean, the universe, the upward, there almost is no upward bound on the number that could be, we could be successful with. It's about enrollment. It's about being successful with those that we enroll. So I don't know whether that's helpful.
And I guess the question I was trying to ask, and you touched on it, Chancellor, was, maybe I'll do it in a sports analogy. If you say you hit 50 points, but you had the opportunity to get 100 points. So here we got 30,000, but we had the opportunity to graduate some number north of that.
Sure.
Well, to say we graduated 30,000, that's awesome, but if you said, but we could have graduated 85,000. Just throwing that absolute number out doesn't say we're doing an awesome job.
Sure.
And we might be.
And I understand that. And I guess what I would suggest is that this is to illustrate where we are based on where we need to be.
Gotcha.
If the state's going to achieve its goal of education attainment, we all could do better. And the state, right now, 55% is our target. We think that's a realistic reach goal, because considering where we are, getting to 55 is going to take an awful lot of work by all the people in this room and others to achieve that. The ideal would be to have 100%, I guess, post-secondary credential workforce. But this is the target that has been set for us as our responsibility. So we are tracking to try to meet our obligation.
Gotcha.
To
so TEHAC set this target.
Yes.
But they set it based on something.
National average.
Trying to get to the national average education attainment.
Well, we have set the TCAT.
And we modified that somewhat.
Set goals for ourselves.
To fold in the TCAT
right.
certificates. Okay. It was not part of the original work done by TEHAC.
And based on current enrollment, it is a stretch goal, because this trajectory is based on an assumption of a 3% annual increase. And right. So it is a stretch goal. So we think you'll
be
pleased.
But you were sandbagging at first, probably. Yeah.
Hmm?
You were sandbagging at first. No, just kidding.
No.
Well, it's going to look like that, but don't worry.
Right.
When we get to the numbers.
Right, exactly.
We'll wait and discuss
that. I see the sandbagging going here, Chandler.
And also, it's important to realize we're just starting some of these strategies that will help us to get to those numbers. So,
Regent Prescott.
I had one question about that. When we're saying the 43,000, so that you're saying that's national average, that's not what would get us to the 55%? Or are those two things the same?
Now, the 43202 is our interpretation of TEHAC's assignment of responsibility that if all sectors did what they are supposed to do, met expectations, Tennessee would be at the national average of education attainment for associate degrees and bachelor's degrees and higher.
Okay.
Now, the Drive to 55 is different, and the Drive to 55 incorporates not only those academic credentials, but also certificates, diplomas, and other credentials that we award through our workforce training programs, be it at TCATS or in a community college setting. So so we think that our share of the Drive to 55 will be very close to 43202. Mm-hmm. That number may change a bit as THEC goes through its next round of strategic planning. They're engaged in that effort right now. And we are hopeful that they will establish new targets that align more directly with the Drive to 55.
So if this is what the share is for TBR institutions, have you drilled that down to think about how many awards does the University of Memphis need to make? How many awards does, TCAD, wherever? Or, I mean, is this taken down? And I know that would differ, I mean, depending
sure.
on the mission and what these institutions are doing, but it seems like we need to drill that down, which you may have, so that each institution really knows what it is responsible for, what its goal is, not just
yes.
increase your completion.
And we have those institutional goals, and correct me here, keep me honest here, Wendy, but we have institutional goals within our current strategic planning time frame,
right.
which is up in 2015, as we now are moving toward the creation of a 10-year strategic plan looking forward to 2025, we'll have those targets for every institution for the next 10 years. Yes, ma'am.
Good. Lots of discussion.
Chancellor, you may want to share with them that 10-item completion strategy.
That was
okay.
Yeah,
yeah.
Those are the strategies that we have adopted as a system to get to the place where we need to go.
And we try to highlight one of them at each of the quarterly meetings.
Oh, okay. Great.
So, Chancellor, Wendy touched on the point about the fact that enrollment is down at some of our universities, which would make it more difficult to get to the 43,000 if that trend continued.
That's right. Which means
that
if we can't grow our enrollment, then we're going to have to do even
better
with the students that we have.
Yes.
And that's exactly what those 10 strategies are about.
And I wanted to take the flip side of that. Because if, let's say that in 2 years, enrollment goes up 6%, right? Mm-hmm. Well, that number that's based on the 3% increase. That's what you said, is that correct?
If it goes up next in 2 years, then we would see that 4 or 5 years out on our trajectory,
right.
that our completion.
So the numbers.
Right.
Yeah, the 3% is what Catherine was saying.
It's
growing awards.
Okay.
We have to grow our productivity, our outcomes by 3%.
But enrollment would be a factor in that.
Yeah, so enrollment.
But let's say if enrollment just goes through the roof,
mm-hmm.
and THEC would change that number to some number north
then
of
we
that.
Will overachieve.
Yes.
That's
yes.
why I started by saying we will award at least
okay.
43,200.
Yeah, and we're going to overachieve even if our enrollments don't go through the roof.
Right.
So. Oh, I understand the number now. Thank you.
Regent Stites.
Thank you, Vice Chancellor. The question I was going to ask goes back to what Mike was saying, in that the governor has set this up not as a higher education program, but as a jobs program. So there's two things that I think we've got to think about. One is, where are we measuring the placement success rate? And then I think it's important that we ask the question, if it's a jobs placement or recruitment of jobs to Tennessee, do we want to say that we are average? Is that the goal we want to put out there, that we are average? Because if we are going to say to business industry, we are average as you compare us with other states, I don't know if that's a consistent message with what we're trying to do.
And
I know you haven't said that. Yeah, that's not your agenda.
But I would just observe that I think we all are somewhat troubled by the notion that we aspire to be average. I hear what you're saying. But when you compare where that would be to where we are, there's a lot of work to be done to get to that point. But I would suggest that 55, and I think the governor would heartily agree with this, that is the minimum. We have to be at least at 55 to support the economy that we have in Tennessee. And the better we can do, the higher that we can drive that number, the better able we are to create the economy we'd like to have, as opposed to the economy we have.
I'm not suggesting it's not a worthy goal. I'm just suggesting may be counter to what we want business to believe about our state.
And 55, and we're probably getting too deep in the weeds here, but 55 is based on the picture of the workforce in Tennessee. That's what it takes to support the workforce in Tennessee. The average attainment was THEC's goal in the public agenda. Those numbers are reasonably close to the same numbers, but from the governor's standpoint, what he has said is, we know based on studies that have been done that if Tennessee's economy is going to thrive, we're going to have at least 55% of our adult workforce with post-secondary credentials by 2025. So that is our target. That is what we believe is the minimum that we will have to have in Tennessee for our economy to be healthy.
Thank you, Chancellor.
Anybody else before Wendy? Hands it over to Dr. Denley. Good discussion.
Yeah, so I guess maybe the takeaway of the morning is that data is a crucial commodity. And there's a sense in which there's more than enough data to go around. The real question is, how are we going to use it? It is the case, I think, that historically the way in which we and many people have used data is retrospectively. You know, much of what I talked about yesterday was, this is the numbers of people that we had in various different categories over the last decade. This is how many graduates we had last year. And so there is this retrospective sense of data. The next step forward from there is instead of looking retrospectively about data, but instead looking at it in some sort of a real-time setting, trying to find ways in which we can create dashboard kinds of technologies and consequently put information in decision-makers' hands so they're able to make strategic decisions in the moment. You know, one of the things that came out of the conversation with Mike is that if we know precisely schools which need to be talked to, and we know now, well then many of you perhaps and others too can have conversations with those schools that change something that might well happen in the future, but it's crucial for you to know now. Knowing in a month's time, it may be interesting in a month's time to look back, but it doesn't do anything. And so work that's happened here at the board over the last, in the most recent years, is to try to create this data capability for us and also for our schools so that we're actually able to see data and to see it in disaggregated kinds of fashion. Because I think, again, what's come out in much of the conversations here, and you should know they're also part of lots of conversations that we have too, is that global numbers, they ask more questions than they answer. You know, the 43,202, the first question that comes to mind is, well, okay, that's how many, but how many bachelor's degrees would that be? How many associate's degrees would that be? How many AAS degrees would that be? How many certificates? In what subjects? What would and the 43 just prompts all of those questions. Well, how do you answer those questions? And so creating this significant data capability to be able to feed the answers to those questions in a meaningful fashion, that's work that's happening and has been happening over the last years. So what we want to do this morning is to show you how that capability is now being implemented. And I guess in uh, in in the fashion of the morning, I'm also going to hand this over to someone else as well, although I will come back and also talk a little about some other work too. I want to introduce Pamela Clippard and Nicolette Searle. They work at the TBR office in an IT unit, which has been working very diligently to take the data from each of our campuses and to move that data seamlessly into a data warehouse, which is both accessible from each of those campuses, but also is accessible from the central office, so that we can run and they can run seamless kinds of dashboard reporting, exactly the kinds of things that we've been talking about wanting to know so much this morning. So I'm going to introduce, I think, Pamela first, who's going to show us really what does that dashboard sort of thing look like. And as she talks about the capabilities, I'll also allude to at least some of the things that perhaps would be of interest from campus leadership and also central office. So,
good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Well, we're excited to be here. What we're going to show today is the capabilities of our common data repository. This has been some time coming, and it's been a wonderful project and a great opportunity for the board. What you're going to see today is data that's live at the campuses. We have the capability to run it at the different campuses, and we use this data to produce one of the most powerful analytic tools to support strategic management of the institutions. My mouse has gone to sleep. I have it now. All right. The Common Data Repository The Common Data Repository is the repository of our Enterprise Data Warehouse System data. So as the campuses enter the data for the student and the courses in the banner system, at night, that data is refreshed into our data warehouse. As all technology, everything has a timer. So we've timed out.
The old adage about acting with children is just as true of technology.
It is. It truly is. But the data that we're going to show today is in support of the Complete College Tennessee Act, and also supports the strategic management of our Drive to 55. So as we were talking about our Drive to 55, how are we going to get there? We have some management tools today using the data that's provided by our Common Data Repository and the work we've done at the Tennessee Board to develop business intelligence using that data. One of the first things we're going to look at is something that's familiar to all of us, and that's our outcomes. Degree productivity. Most campuses have not had the ability to look at data in such a way. This is a dashboard. Dashboards are an excellent tool for visualizing strategic management information.
That's pretty awesome.
It allows us to research and explore trends and analysis of the data, and it helps us to identify relationships between the data objects. This first, I'd like to say we have developed this so that you can, as an executive, have a quick overview of the data. You can move into detailing the data, and you can look at trends in the data. This is degree productivity, which is reported annually. So we're looking at reporting years, and we're looking at 7 years worth of data. I'd like to take this time to say thank you to Tennessee State University for allowing us to use this data this morning, and 2014 and 2015 has not finished yet, so those lines will come up as we know this school is working diligently in producing their graduates from the campus. Also, another way to look at information is by academic period. So Tennessee Higher Education Commission defines the reporting year as summer, fall, and spring. And so we've also broken down the information to look at summer, fall, and spring across the 7 years. We've provided a yellow line to demonstrate our Pell students. The rust-colored line are our STEM students, and the adult learners have a gray bar across the histogram to show us the trends in those three subpopulations.
So you can already see something different about the character of this data, other than what I've shown you before. You know, the fact that 2014-15 is there, you know, we've only had one graduation period during this year, so there are, you know, 200 students who have graduated this year so far. It's reasonable to ask questions like, well, is that typical? And so now you can actually go back and see. Look at summer 2014. Summer 2014 is 199 students. Summer 2013 was 189. Summer 2012 was 192. So you can see, you know, 199 is, it's better than average, but it's the sort of number that you might expect. In previous years, you would have been able to say, well, we got 200. Let's hope we get some more later on in the year. Similarly, you can now see trends in important subpopulations. So you can really see how the kinds of initiatives that Tennessee State have put in place to work specifically with important subpopulations on their campus, like students who are Pell eligible and adults, there's been a very consistent growth in the numbers of graduates that they've had in each of those categories, and you can begin to see exactly how that plays out.
One of the features we've built into this dashboard is if you do not have time to come online, this data can be emailed to you and be scheduled to be sent to your inbox as a PDF. We're going to go further down in the chart.
So Trixton.
Sir.
I see the graduation data. Can you overlay that with enrollment data?
Yes.
That's pretty cool.
One of the features of this is, so there are more dashboards than you can shake a stick at, many more than we can show today.
I figured as much.
And and one of the nice things, and one of the things I'm going to show later, is that if for whatever reason what you see is not what you want, well then you can pull the data out, and then you can use some other kind of analysis tool to answer some other kind of question. But the data is sitting right there.
That's just below awesome. Our top charts, you can see we've broken down the data into subpopulations looking at degree level. If you're a university, you'll see your undergraduates, graduates, and master's programs, as well as a few of our university campuses do have our associate's degrees. And we have ethnicity. We also have award trends. We've built in a feature where if the lines overlap and you really want to see the number under the line, you can click out one of the lines, click back in one of the lines to look at the data.
So there again, you can see for TSU the steady increase of the number of graduate degrees that they've been awarding. This is actually a very crucial part of the funding formula, and especially true for TSU. And so that steady increase is a very important statistic for them to look at.
A little bit further down into the chart, we're going to break it down even further into the average completion time in years across the 7 years, and also looking at the completion time overlaid with the Pell, STEM, and adult student line chart across the histogram bars. And I'm going to move over just a little bit. These were designed for your desktop, so we do a little scrolling when we have to move to the laptop. Then we can see also the average GPA that was attained during those years.
One of the other very nice features about this is, which is admittedly rather in the weeds, but it's well worth pointing out, is that many of these kinds of statistics, yeah, you could imagine half a dozen different reasonable ways to count numbers of degrees. Or let's say we are saying counting numbers of people who are Pell eligible students who graduate. So what do I mean by that? Do I mean they were Pell eligible at some point? They received actually a Pell grant? They were Pell recipients all the time that they were studying? Any of those are perhaps reasonable definitions. So which one is it? And all of those, that specificity now in that sidebar. So if you want to know, well, so what are we counting there? So you can easily find that out in the descriptors on the side, which is a useful feature.
Thank you. We've added that feature because oftentimes when we'll go into a dashboard, we need to think, what were we really looking for and what were we looking at? And So the description we've added at the sidebar, and we've used the description that was provided by THEC whenever possible, or whichever governing body we are actually reporting for. As an additional feature for this, we have a click-on capability that will take you out to the THEC site so that you can look at the figures of your specific school for past year reporting. It may take a little time to come up, so.
Can I ask a question while it's coming up?
Surely.
So Trixton, graduation rates, the data that you're showing now is historical data. Mm-hmm. How about data surrounding class attendance, dropout, people dropping out mid-semester? How about data that drives the graduation rates? Because to change the outcome, to know what they're doing on a daily, weekly, monthly mm-hmm. basis would help change the outcome.
Yeah, and I guess where I want to go once we've been through showing this capability is actually, you know, the next stage on after where were we, where are we, is where are we going to be? And so it is now the case that by being able to bring together, this is perhaps the difference of being able to look at data on a system level. So there now is such a large and rich data set that we really can bring predictive analytics kinds of techniques to bear to be able to say, yeah, look, we need to step in here and intervene with a student who's in this situation, and then we can really scale those kinds of techniques. And I'm gonna show a little of that.
Okay, so you have that data well. It's pretty cool.
So I hear the questions coming in about detail capability. So we do have the detail as a dashboard as well. Now this is the count. This is the count of certificates for the entire year span. If you've asked for 10 years worth of information, you'll get 10 years worth of information. I'll show in just a moment how we can narrow that down to 1 or 2 years so we can look more specifically at our recent figures. On the first page, we saw degree level. This is what it looks like in a breakdown by percentages and ratios. And next to that chart, we have tabular information that supports the information we're showing in the chart. One of the features that's built in is that this is a lot of information to view on a screen, and anyone's eyes would become tired after a while researching this much information. There's a built-in capability to right-click on that data and be able to save and download that data into an Excel spreadsheet so that you can do additional information analysis at your own time, maybe print it out, take it to the airport with you while you're traveling and saying, yeah, my figures support that. That's great.
Makes very good plain reading because it's very soothing, makes you
drop off. You can load Regent Freeman up with some of that.
Maybe
he'll enjoy that.
If you could show maybe to give some sort of a taste of the kind of the level of detail we can get to, there's a report that really shows how students are moving around major to major. And this is traditionally been, this is awkward kinds of data to be able to really be able to fish out from the traditional ways that we've been able to analyze data, but this is, it's now, if we can find the right place, it's a seamless part of this kind of reporting. There we go. Are we able to get to that today?
Yeah, it's on the detail tab.
Oh, that's right.
It's at the very bottom of our detail tab. Have a cheerleader in the back.
There we go. As Pamela said, this was designed for a desktop, and there's just not as much real estate on a
laptop.
On a projector.
And so we apologize. But this is the information that I think will answer some questions. We did find the data, and we do have the data, to tell us when a student comes in at admissions, which programs they've admitted. And then at graduation, which program are they in at graduation? How many students changed from their admitted declared majors into different majors. And the top portion is by institution, because institutions take a much more tighter definition on their programs. And below we have the federal definition of that program. So you see where we can see and identify where our students are moving to throughout their matriculation through the program.
So you can already see that while students change their major, they don't change it wildly. They don't move from neuroscience to art history. Some of them do, but not so often.
Yes. Another feature, of course, is trending analysis. Let me get my scroll bars where I can find them, because it's a laptop. There we have. Yeah. Quite a bit of information on this page. We have reporting year trends with a 3-year trending analysis across the 7 years. Again, we're looking at the Pell and the STEM and the adult students in our line chart across the histogram bars. We have the percentage change. So everywhere above the line of the average, we are showing a great amount of information there. We know how much we're changing. This is the degree level and the degree level percentage in changes. Again, we have click on and click off features so that you can read underlying data when the data overlaps. And then also we have tabular information as you go through that shows the 3-year associates, the bachelors, the numbers actually, and you can highlight years and go across from one particular set of information you may be interested in all the way across to your degree and the changes in the associates, changes in bachelors, the certificates awarded. So quite a bit of information in this particular dashboard.
So those are the kinds of, the spirit of the overall kind of trend reporting. Also wanted to show you another kind of capability that we have. Wanted to move on to the OLAPs if we can.
Yes, let's do that. Because students just don't come in our front door and out our back door, they spend an amount of time with us. And I'm going to turn this over to my colleague, Nicolette Searle, and she's going to show us the statistics that support student progression.
So this OLAP capability is, I don't know how many of you are Excel nerds like myself, but in Excel there's this concept of a pivot table, so you can take pieces of data and then disaggregate it by various different kinds of subpopulations. Maybe you're curious, well, okay, that's how many graduates you have, but how does that break down by race or gender, or race and gender, or maybe race, gender, and the counties they came from, or you can imagine all kinds of ways in which you might want to slice and dice that information. So this what's called OLAP capability allows you to take this, well, the technical term is a data cube, so we'll not use it, a data cube, and then rearrange it, subdivide it in ways that try to help you to answer questions. I know this has been a long-standing want of the chancellor's to say, well, okay, so how does, if this is how many graduates we have that look like this, well, what if they don't look exactly like that? Maybe they look a little bit like this. Well, how does that look, and how does it compare? And so this OLAP capability really does that. So I'll hand over to Nicolette so you can see how that plays out.
All right, so one of the things that we are looking at here is we're looking at actual student progression. So I've pulled up Nashville State Community College because we started with the university on the degree progression. So one of the things we want to look at is how does a student actually progress towards their degree? And one of the ways that we do that is by measuring where they're hitting those benchmarks at the community colleges and at the universities. What you'll notice here is that benchmarks for community colleges that 12, 24, and 36 credit hours, and the benchmarks for a university is 24, 48, and 72. But what we've done is we've included all of those benchmarks regardless of what institution you're at for the OLAP cube. The reason why we've done that is because you at a university may decide that you'd like to see how many students are hitting that 12-hour benchmark to make sure that you're on track for your 24-hour benchmark. So one of the things that we have pulled up here for Nashville State is the actual number of students who hit those particular benchmarks. A student can benchmark more than once, meaning that you may have a student that's in the 12-hour and the 24. And we've given it the capability to pull down these dimensions across the top. So you could pull in, for instance, I would like to look by the academic period, which is the term code, to see how that breaks down across the terms within that reporting year. So I can see here in 2014-10, we had 917 that hit the 12-hour benchmark at Nashville State Community College. Some of the other things I may want to look at, maybe by that particular academic period, I want to look at a specific classification of students. So if I drop classification down, it then redraws that cube and gives me those numbers for the freshman and sophomore classes. If I'm only interested in a specific reporting period, I can take out all of those reporting periods and only include the one that I'm interested in. And it will redraw itself, and now I can only see those particular academic periods with those classifications. So there's a lot of drilled down capabilities built into this particular system. One of the things I'd like to show you is some of the more advanced features that will come in handy. So I'm going to take these and prop them back up and then include all of my years again here. One of the things that we put a emphasis on are your students who are Pell eligible. So we have a Pell option across the top. And you'll see there are a lot of dimensions here. So here's my Pell eligible indicator. If I drop that down, now I can see which students were Pell eligible, which students were not Pell eligible. We've also included a dimension for student ID. So if I need to pull out specific students that fall into that Pell eligibility indicator, I can pull those particular student IDs out and then again export this information to Excel for further analysis.
It's a good example of Regent Freeman was talking about a few seconds ago. One of the tabs is holds. So, you know, let's say you have a hold on your account because you didn't pay a library fine or you didn't pay a parking ticket or something. Well, it would be nice to know who those students are, because I think all in all, we'd far rather they were enrolled in taking classes rather than owing us $20 because they didn't park in the right place. Well, so knowing who those students are, we're able to just simply go in here, drop a couple of things, and immediately we could get a list of those students. Now we have all that contact information, and somebody could be tasked with contacting those people and said, hey, guess what, did you know? Sometimes they don't know. Sometimes they say they don't know, but you know.
So is there a chart in here that shows, that tracks, let's take Nashville State. Let's say they've got 10,000 students. Mm-hmm. So you're able to break in there. How many of them are on a path to completing 2 years? How many of them have been in here for longer? So you can track that as well, so we know what progress we're making that impacts our graduation rates. So we're sitting here trying to figure out what is causing that graduation rate, say, to be 20% rather than what we might want it to be, because then we can look at the number of students, full-time, part-time, how long they've been here, things like that.
That's correct? Exactly right. Now okay. We can dice things down much more granularly rather than just simply counting at the end and saying, right. Well, this is how many we had. Now we have a much more granular continuum all the way through from admission all the way through till graduation. Okay. Or, you know, as you say, it is the case that sometimes students, they don't finish. And so trying to have that forensic understanding of, so what happened? Where did things go awry?
One of the other things that you have the ability to do within this tool is to create groups of people. So I drop down the academic age, which is also another key indicator in our funding formula. So I'm going to take in the academic age, and I'm going to create a folder just called adult. I'm going to take the 77, drag all the way up to the 25 for our adult learner students, drag that population into that adult folder, create another one for the non-adult group, grab those people, click on, and now I have put those together into folders and classified those groups of people for a much cleaner look within that report. Now, one of the key things that makes this extremely important is I can also create graphs directly from this tool. So if I want to look at a current reporting year, and I really don't want it into a bar chart, maybe I want it a pie chart. And I really don't like those colors, red and green, mainly because I know people who are colorblind. So now I can change those particular colors. Which one is it? The colors. change it to maybe the pastel colors. And now I can take this particular graph, export it into any type of report that I need for on-the-go data.
So just to kind of close up, I wanted to give at least a taste of, I think already you understand that there's an enormous amount of capability here that really allows senior management, both at campuses and here at the board, to be able to really make some very strategic kinds of decisions once this is fully implemented. But I also wanted to show you how it is that we can use the data when it's kind of rolled up. So I wanted to at least, how do we flip back over to,
So Tristan, while you're doing, does this give us a better snapshot? We've talked about this before. Mm-hmm. Rather than having to wait 6 to 12 months to really understand enrollment trends, so that now as we're sitting down looking at budgeting,
yes,
so actually we can come in and have a much better snapshot of what we ought to anticipate, rather than, because often we are tracking backwards.
That's right.
Waiting for data against
this. Well, this exactly gets to my comment of saying, okay, going from what was to what now, yes. You can see we know what is very accurately, and now the work that's currently happening is to develop all the predictive analysis to say what will be, based on where we are now, knowing the present very well, much better than we ever have before, to what degree are we able to envisage the future, and so consequently make strategic decisions now that affect where we will be.
Right.
Absolutely. So the last example is really to take all of this data, and if we pull it out, then we have flexibility to use it in different ways. One of the things that I think we focused on a lot is it makes a difference what program students choose, but does it matter that they choose? When they first arrive at a campus, how much difference do they make if they walk on campus and really don't know exactly what they want to do? So this was some work that that my office did, I guess, well, earlier this year, and we wanted to create a sort of a paradigm to be able to see this. And part of that paradigm is to understand this on a student-by-student basis, not some sort of aggregated approach. So this is a picture of all of the roughly 4,500 students in the university system who began in fall 2010, and then as they rise up the screen, they are earning student credit hours. The colors actually make a difference. So in that particular semester, their GPA, if it's above 3, they're green. And if they are between two and three, they're yellow, and lower than that, they're red. And they turn into one of those little white dots when they drop out. So let me show you one more time. I think I can do that. There we go. So now you can see how this looks in an aggregate setting, but in a way in which you can think of each student as an individual. As Dr. Wise said earlier this morning, we're about narratives that unfold one by one, not mass by mass. Well, so that's nice. The reason why we chose universities is because in the community college setting, the normal practice is when students come in and they don't know precisely, then they're enrolled into an associate's degree in general studies. And that's perfectly natural. But it does mean that we can't distinguish between someone who actively chooses that and someone who is simply placed into that. In the university setting, they are distinguished as undecided, and we can see that. So now let's look at the same kind of chart, but now we're going to bunch them together when they decide. So as they decide, as a student makes a decision, they now collect to the right, exactly the same chart. Now you can see that over that time period, more than half of the students never chose anything at all. They left before they chose anything at all. This is a stunning picture in the sense that I think the tradition has always been to think, well, people figure it out in the end. Well, actually, all the people who stay figure it out in the end. The ones who don't figure it out, they leave. Of course, it isn't the case that we might say, well, we could just require them to choose. Yeah, then we'd have a whole bunch of people who leave who had checked a box. So what this has done is to help us realize that it very much matters for us to empower students to be able to understand their direction. And it's changed our overall system-wide approach to that. So we have created these, what we call academic foci. They are affinity groups of programs, so that when students first arrive on campus, well, if they know what their degree program is, we'll go for it. But if you don't know exactly what your degree program is, well, then we can help you to understand, probably you already will identify with one of these affinity groups. most students, when you talk about it in this way, they say, well, no, I don't know exactly what I want to do, but I know I don't want to be that. I know I want to be this. And you say, well, great, then let's begin with that focus, and then we'll refine that choice down to your individual program as you succeed. There's good data that shows that making that kind of decision helps them succeed at greater rates, and it clearly helps us to understand how we can advise them more effectively. So that's at least a down payment of how it is that we can kind of use this data both on a real-time basis to make strategic decisions, but also ways in which we can influence our overall policies and procedures across the system. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
That's awesome.
Thank you, Eric. That is awesome. Yeah. And as Catherine's coming back up, this is still under construction. I mean, we're not fully implemented yet, probably never will be finished. It's a project that will continue to go on, but we're making significant progress, and I believe we will be able to begin to answer your questions much more effectively as we move forward. Catherine, you want to wrap us up?
Thank you. The data that I'm going to show now relative to what you've just seen is going to look very simplistic, but I have the pleasure today of sharing our progress towards those completion goals that Vice Chancellor Thompson was sharing with you earlier. And I do say pleasure because for the 2013-2014 academic year, we are above trajectory for all of our goals. So I come bearing good news. So this chart should now be familiar to you. This is our goal. 2025 goal is 43,202 credentials, but we also established an annual goal. You can see the 2013-2014 goal there as 30,756 credentials. Now, we didn't just set the overall goal, we also established goals for each of four credential levels. Those were bachelor, associate, community college certificates, and TCAT awards. We established annual goals for each of those, and the 2013-2014 goals are now showing on your screen. Again, these are based on bachelor and associate guided by THEC public agenda. The system office worked to develop the certificate and TCAT goals. So how did we do this year towards these goals? Here's bachelor, associate, community college certificate, and TCAT awards. Right, yay. I should just note that TCATs are on a slightly different schedule, so the TCAT numbers are preliminary, but we don't expect it to drop below that trajectory number. So as you can see, for all four, we are above trajectory.
Quick question. Sure. Community college certificates, explain that number.
And I'll try to do that real quickly because I know we're pressed for time. When THEC first established the outcome-based formula, certificates at community colleges were identified as one of those outcomes. That prompted, we'd always been in the certificate business at the community colleges, but that certainly prompted much more focus on creating certificates and programs at our community colleges. So we responded to the incentive, as is usually true. And created a lot of opportunities for students at our community colleges to achieve certificates. As it turns out, through subsequent conversation with THEC, not all those certificates count for funding purposes. So this is the gross number of certificates.
Correct.
And over time, now that there's more definition has been brought to what are those certificates that count for THEC's funding purposes, we'll see those numbers moderate, I think, somewhat as we go forward. We overachieved in terms of creation of certificate opportunities. But since they didn't turn into cash, we're likely to see some of that now moderate.
Okay. Does
that make sense? Mm-hmm. Yep. It's pretty crass, but that's...
My question about the certificates, is that a certificate that the institution is designing that they give, or they manufacturer recognized certificates that say these students are ready for a job?
They include both industry recognized certificates in various areas as well as certificates that are created at the institution to signify
for example, completion of the general education requirement. Many of those certificates probably relate to the gen ed, the award of the gen ed certificate, which we believe has meaning and will become to be something that is recognized as a credential of value, but it's new and it's something we've just started with.
So taken together, what does that mean for our overall progress toward our goal? Well, the green line you see there, that is the annual goal, ending in 43,202. The blue bars show our annual progress towards those goals. So those numbers I just show you all added up equal 36,982 credentials awarded in the 2013-2014 academic year, which is slightly above what we awarded last year and definitely above our trajectory overall.
A little sandbagging going on here.
That's where I knew the sandbagging conversation was
going. A little sandbagging
going on here.
That pretty
well proves it.
It proves it, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So that concludes my report, and I should say that this is a testament to the work that all the hard work that's happening on the campuses.
Absolutely.
So I will now turn it back to Vice Chancellor Thompson.
Who will very quickly show us
it'll be quicker than I anticipated, but it'll be just enough. We've established a completion webpage that you can go to and anyone can go to get information about progress on the goal. And other information related to how we do our work in the CDU. So we're going to show you the web link. Okay. So just quickly want to show you a little bit of what's in the website. We've got a link to the guiding documents, the THEC public agenda, information on Drive to 55, so that when you go to the website, you know what you're looking at and why we're doing it. We have, that's not it. We have all the reports we've done for you at the quarterly board meetings and all of the reports we do to the chancellor. We do many more reports to the chancellor, including things we call stock takes. All of those are on the website, as well as progress toward our goal. The web link is gonna come up in a minute. But that's it up there, completionagenda.tbr.edu. If you have a moment, take a look. Right. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Wendy. And Madam Chair, that concludes my report.
Good report. Lots of good discussion. And thanks to Wendy and Tristan and Pamela and Nicolette and Catherine. Good work. Let's build on these two conversations and our reports from the presidents and directors. And as Catherine just said, all of this is due to the hard work of all of these folks over the last few years. You have evidence of much of that hard work and their successes in our newsletters that they always share very generously with us. So we won't dwell on those highlights. Take a look at those at your convenience. But we do want to hear the promise connection in our reports of our presidents and directors today, and we will begin with Dr. Glover speaking on behalf of our great public universities. There she is. How are you?
Fine. Good morning. Thank you.
You have a big scholarship dinner this weekend, do you not?
Tonight, yes.
Very good. All right. Thank you for being with us this morning.
Thank you. Vice Chancellor Reynolds, other members of the Tennessee Board of Regents, Chancellor Morgan, thank you for this opportunity to truly, it's a rich privilege to speak to you on behalf of the six public institutions in our state. Even though this report is provided on behalf of our six universities, I would just be remiss if I didn't just take a moment, 30 seconds, in this report and tell you about, update you on our initiative we talked to you about in June. Our book bundle initiative. It is just going just very well, and we're just so pleased and excited that the book bundle, along with the tablets, the students are just excited about it. We'll have more about that later. Secondly, it is homecoming on our campus, so we're excited about that. And it's important to me personally, and it's important because we have quite a few donors on campus today. Having said that, I'd like to report that the university presidents have held meaningful discussions and One of the items we discussed is the potential impact of Tennessee Promise, the initiative on the six public universities, as well as our plans to address the enrollment declines that may occur. First, the projected enrollment declines. Each of the four-year institutions expect declines in enrollment in 2015 for the new first-year students from Tennessee. But declines are expected to range from a low of 0.5% to a higher point of 7%. However, there should be a positive effect in the following 2 years, since an increase in enrollment is expected in 2017, resulting from students transferring from the community colleges and hopefully continuing their four-year institutions in Tennessee. We address several initiatives in connection with the possible declines. Primarily, we'll focus on enhancing the support services that we offer to transfer students, including increased focus on transfer credits. And most of the institutions already work closely with community colleges, and the efforts will be expanded even more. In fact, we will seek to improve our customer service to all students to make sure that we offer the highest level of assistance possible. Another possibility was to continue to enhance the breadth of our strategies and energies committed to our growth agenda. Then we're going to review articulation agreements and ensure that they are monitored and useful. And we'll place heavy emphasis on constructive partnerships with community colleges to enhance a seamless transfer of the students. We discussed the implementation of targeted marketing of the four-year college experience. Another consideration was to hold tuition flat to increase competitiveness. Of course, only one school was interested in doing that. We talked about repositioning scholarships and employing some alternative strategies for scholarships. We'll encourage dual enrollment in programs in community colleges and universities. And we will target other students that were not eligible for Tennessee Promise. So you see, we did a lot of discussion, and we covered quite a bit of ground about the activities pertaining to Tennessee Promise. But there are some possibilities. We said as part of our deliberations, we mentioned that enrollment is likely to increase among the out-of-state student population. So maybe it's time for us to reevaluate the out-of-state tuition formula. A second possibility was to consider in-state tuition for students from major metropolitan areas where many of our students reside, such as Atlanta, Chicago, St. Louis, etc. In fact, if 3 out of 10 students remain in Tennessee, 3 out of 10 out-of-state students remain in Tennessee, it'll help the mission of the Drive to 55. So finally, there are some opportunities associated with Tennessee Promise. In some respects, Tennessee Promise could provide a unique opportunity to market higher education in Tennessee based substantially on quality. Because this is particularly true since the distribution of higher education resources in our state is performance-based. And many states are now employing that model. And it allows the Tennessee to market TBR schools as the national leaders in performance funding. So this ultimately should lead to an increased value of education in the state of Tennessee. And the second point was that the six institutions could focus more heavily on expanding their brand and niche areas. The idea would be to market all six universities together based on the various niche areas. So in addition to selling our state as for being known for other things such as music, it allows us the opportunity to brand education from a wholesome standpoint and focus on our specific niche areas and allows for more concentrated marketing and advertising efforts in that regard. So, Vice Chairman Reynolds, thank you for the opportunity to speak with you and present the report from our six institutions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate the good work that you and your colleagues are doing on this.
Thank you very much.
Who are you guys playing tomorrow for the homecoming game?
We're playing FAMU. That band isn't coming. Thank you.
Thank you. Safe travels.
Thank you.
So, any questions before Dr. Glover leaves us, by the way? No. Thank you very much. Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Dr. Wise, our host, returns for the report from our community colleges.
Vice Chair Reynolds, Chancellor Morgan, members of the Board of Regents. I wanted to follow up again with a conversation about Tennessee Promise, which has obviously been a big topic of conversation among the community colleges over the last several months. I want to start by sort of reaffirming many of the things that you heard yesterday in Dr. Denley's sort of enrollment report, and I kind of referenced that this morning. Many of our community colleges are sort of experiencing that downward end of the enrollment arch, as I believe he called it yesterday, but really believe the Tennessee Promise can be a game changer. We touched on some of those factors in terms of that downward enrollment arch, an improving economy, many non-traditional or adult students returning to the workforce. I think it's also important to note that in our conversations about the Tennessee Promise, that a similar support program does not exist for working adult students in the community colleges at this time. And those students who are not Pell eligible among that working adult student population do have difficulty in access to our institution. So it's something that we're thinking about in terms of our institutional dollars and our foundation support for our student populations. Now that Tennessee Promise is in place for recent high school graduates, how do we as institutions respond with additional levels of support for working adults and helping them gain the access that can help them be successful and our institutions be successful as well. Also a lot of conversation about focusing on the retention of those particular students in our institution. Some other factors perhaps related to that enrollment decline for us as a group, again, the difficulty in retaining those students who need significant amounts of wraparound services in terms of childcare and transportation. And we may have more of those students with that first generation student who are coming into our institutions. All of the institutions, I think you heard from Mike Krause this morning, are involved in cross promotion of the Tennessee Promise. We've enthusiastically hosted events on campus. If you follow our web pages and social media, there's lots of conversation out there in that particular form of communication. Had special visits to campus, working with counselors, hosting events. We talked about the enrollment day. We had the picture at Motlow that's kind of maybe gone a little viral. We'll say, encouraging folks to mentor, billboard presentations. There's one president here with a car magnet on their vehicle, at least. So looking for every single possible way to get the folks in our communities to be aware of what a great opportunity this is. And really, we're entering a critical phase over the course of the next month because as of November 2nd, that opportunity is closed for the class of 2015. And we understand that, and we're working very diligently to make sure that every single student who needs that opportunity understands that opportunity and gets a chance to take care advantage of that opportunity. We expect as community colleges, given the awareness, given the fact that we've crossed 20,000 applicants and we're likely to cross 30,000 before we get done, we're expecting enrollment increases at our institutions next fall among this particular population. I think there's some variance among the institutions about how much to expect. I know those institutions like Pellissippi State or Walter State or Roan State who've been part of what started as Knox Achieves and Tennessee Achieves are probably expecting more modest increases since this program has been available in our communities. And those institutions that are exploring this last dollar scholarship opportunity for the first time are expecting greater increases. But we're all excited. We all believe we have capacity to grow back into the sort of top of that enrollment arch. Again, Dr. Denley showed you yesterday. The last thing I want to bring to your attention is you've seen the community college report. I snuck in there as an insert pages 4 and 5 of a publication by the Center for Community College Student Engagement, which lists 13 high impact practices towards completion. I just wanted to make you aware that all of our institutions are engaged in a number of those practices on our campus. Believe that if we're going to be successful, that we're going to have to be able to engage in those practices, not only with the first generation students coming as a result of Tennessee Promise, but also with the working adult student population on our campuses. It's my intention as serving in this role as we move through the course of this year, really to have some conversations with you about those practices, how they're employed on our campuses, hopefully have some data that shows what level of success we're having as we move through this year. And how we're working to make sure we can support all of our students towards success at our individual institutions. That's my report. Vice Chair Reynolds, I'll stand for questions if there are any.
Supporting student success one story at a time. Right?
Exactly.
Right. Questions, comments? Again, great work. Lots of collaboration.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Dwight Murphy, who has done an outstanding job as the director of our TCAT here in Knoxville. You're the next contestant.
Well, good morning, Chair Reynolds.
Good morning.
And Board of Regents, and also our Chancellor and our colleagues. Well, I hope you've had a good visit to Knoxville. And we thank Dr. Wise for the wonderful job that he's done and the hospitality he's shown. Could we give him just a good hand for what he and his staff have done? I love working with Dr. Wise. We'd like to welcome our new board members, and we would encourage each of you to visit one or all of our 27 TCATs scattered across the state. We've had a busy time since you last met. Leading up to Labor Day in 2014, Labor Secretary Tom Perez traveled across the country to talk to Americans about how we can help more people succeed in the workplace. He visited TCAT in Memphis to look at the Tennessee model. The TCATs are being modeled across this nation for the job that's being done. So I think it was the first time in the history that a U.S. Secretary has visited the Memphis campus. So Labor Secretary, he toured the industrial maintenance, electronics technology, machine tool technology, and automotive technology where students demonstrated their state-of-the-art technology utilized in their training. After the tour, he engaged in a roundtable discussion with TCAT Memphis students and instructors. And Regent Prescott, I think you participated. And so we had a great turnout. I think the response was just very, very favorable. And he wanted to try the new virtual welding machine. I think he decided to keep his day job after that trial, though. We're excited about being part of the prospects of the Tennessee Promise. We're preparing. We will be ready. We expect increased enrollments. In fact, on October the 18th, if you can get to TCAT, we're going to have Scholarship Saturday from 10 to 2. Every TCAT, we're going to give you pizza and something, some refreshments. So that's going to happen from Memphis to Elizabeth. And if you can come by, we'd love to have you. All 27 TCATs have conducted counselor, CTE teacher, administrator workshops, luncheons, breakfasts. TCAT Knoxville had 89 high school counselors, every counselor from Blount, Anderson, and Knox County. And Regent Varlin was there to do a presentation for the board. We had a great time, didn't we? In addition, a number have already hosted open house nights. TCAT Livingston is hosting a Promise Week with an open house on September the 25th. TCAT Memphis will partner with Shelby County Schools and Communications Broadcast Services. The Next Step television show will highlight TBR colleges and universities. Memphis conducted Promise workshops at the Boys and Girls Club in September. TCAT Athens held a Promise kickoff in August. The event was attended by high school counselors, administrators, representatives of industry. Randy Boyd hosted a plant manager meeting concerning TCAT Promise and Drive to 55 at TCAT Athens. We are 100% involved in getting the mentors on board. We're going to lock our folks in rooms and make them sign up. It's painless. If you haven't done it, I'm not too savvy, but I've already done mine. I think Chrissy must have caught 7 people before she left this morning, because we're at 107. When I came in this morning, we were 100, so I saw her out in the hall with her iPad. I'm not sure, but I suspect that she got some folks on board right there. We've been involved in our communities. We're grassroots, which is truly the heartbeat of our success. TCAT Newbern has been selected as the eligible training partner for the year of for LWI 12 and the Regional Partner of the Year Award for Goodwill Career Solutions. TCAT Crump recently celebrated their 50th anniversary. Congratulations to TCAT Whiteville. They've just gone through their COE reaccreditation, and they look at 300 criteria, and it takes a year and a half to get ready. They had no recommendations. Everything was really good. We wish good luck to Morristown TCAT. They're getting ready in October for their COE evaluation. Congratulations to Whiteville. They received $124,000 grant from the Memphis BioWorks Foundation to assist in students with tuition, books, and supplies for the health information technology. TCAT Jackson is teaching a class called Way to Win under a dual enrollment agreement with Milan High School and Bradford High School in Gibson County. This 36-hour contact class is about personal finance. The Way to Win is what the class is called. By the end of this fall term, there will be 120 high school students to complete the course. McMinnville is in a partnership with Middle Tennessee Rural Entry Program that was awarded a grant to provide computer training for inmates in Coffee, Franklin, and Warren counties. TCAT on out of Huntsville, I would be remiss if I didn't ask you, if you haven't looked at the sculptures, please look at the sculptures. This is the bear is a secondary student who is now enrolled as a post-secondary, and the snake is a post-secondary student. They won the state skills competition, and they won the national competition. Never been done by a teacher in one program, so we congratulate them. Lastly, we want to honor TCAT directors Mark Powers and Don Sadler. They've been friends of mine. Mark was a mentor early on when I started work, and I believe we have some recognitions for them later, so I won't get into that, but we're going to miss them. We wish them luck. We hope they have a good time in retirement. And both Vice Chair, we encourage you and other board members to review the newsletter that you should have in front of you, subject to questions. Anything? Any questions? Thank you.
My only question is, do you have enough going on?
we just scratched the surface.
You all are amazing. Thank you, Dwight. Thank you. Scholarship Saturday, October 18th.
Please come.
Sounds like fun. 27 conveniently located TCATs to serve you. So, well done. Thank you all. And again, that important tie back to Mike's presentation and what we learned today about the promise. So it's an exciting time, very exciting time. We have a little bit of unfinished business, folks, we need your approval to some changes in our bylaws. We gave notice for this back, I think, at our June meeting. And Mary, would you refresh our memories, please?
Yes. We've got several changes. The proposed revisions include ministerial changes that change the numbering and name. Previously, on our policy and guideline website, there were a number of resource documents, including the bylaws that were under the 600 policy series, and we have taken that numbering and applied it to our new sex discrimination, harassment, and sexual misconduct policies you approved yesterday or earlier today. And so we're moving the bylaws to a new section called resource documents, and so you're approving that change. We're also proposing a revision to section 1C1 of the bylaws, adding language clarifying that the state university and community college system includes the colleges of applied technology. There's a change to section 7F of the bylaws, adding language that would allow a committee to meet in the absence of a quorum to hear informational reports. A proposed revision to section 7I adds language clarifying that in the absence of the chairman of the board, the vice chairman shall be an ex officio member of all committees with the authority to vote. And lastly, a proposed revision to section 7M1E, changing the name of the Committee on Public Affairs to the Committee on External Affairs and setting out the duties of the newly renamed committee.
Thank you. We need a motion to approve those changes, please.
I'll move it. Second.
Thank you. Motion from Regent Griscom, seconded by Regent Roddy. And any further discussion or questions? If not, Mary, would you call the roll? Yes.
Regent Griscom?
Aye.
Regent Commissioner Johnson?
Aye.
Regent Markham?
Aye.
Regent Prescott?
Aye.
Regent Reeves?
Aye.
Regent Reynolds?
Aye.
Regent Roddy?
Aye.
Regent Shockey?
Aye.
Regent Smith?
Aye.
Regent Stites?
Aye.
Regent Thomas? Excuse me. Regent Varlin?
Aye.
And Regent Webb?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you very much. And we have a notice regarding additional revisions to the bylaws, Mary, that may be coming at our December meeting.
Yes, as we noted before, changes to the bylaws must be noticed at the meeting preceding the meeting at which they're acted upon. So we're hereby giving you notice that proposed revisions will be considered regarding Section 7, Committees of the Board, relative to the charters of standing committees and institutional ex officio non-voting members.
Thank you. And thanks to everybody for your help on this. It's important to take a fresh look at bylaws from time to time. It's important to make sure that our committees are aligning with everything we're trying to do in this drive to 55. So thank you, and we'll be back in touch. That was an information item only, this last one, so we don't require any action. But we are moving into new business now, where we do have about five action items before us. We are in the home stretch, gang. We first need to approve our proposed dates to meet in calendar 2015. Chancellor Morgan.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think each of you have received the proposed meeting dates for 2015. As is typical, we will have two meetings. The March meeting and December meeting will be at the TBR system office. The dates would be Friday, March 27th and Thursday, December 10th. And then the two meetings in mid-year would be June 18th and 19th at Columbia State Community College, and September 16th and 17th at Jackson State Community College.
Very good. May we have a motion to approve those dates for 15?
So moved.
Thank you, Regent Prescott. A second?
Second.
From Regent Markham, thank you. Any further discussion?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Chancellor, can we also, in the very near future, get the actual dates for our committee meetings?
Yes.
So that we're able to put those sure. on the calendar, too, since I've yes. missed the last one and,
yes.
and would like to make sure I can get those built in before my wife decides where she wants
what
to
the next schedule is. I understand. Yes, sir, we will do that.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Very good point. If there's no further discussion, we need a voice vote on this. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you. We now have dates for 2015 and committee dates on their way. Regent Roddy, you have some minutes for us to approve.
I certainly do. The Personnel and Compensation Committee met in a regular session yesterday to review and recommend approval of the following items: tenure upon appointment at universities and community colleges, proposed revisions to TBR sick leave policy 5:01:09, faculty promotion addendum, proposed revisions to TBR policies on sexual misconduct, institutional compensation proposals, and lastly, Chancellor's performance evaluation is presented. As chair of the committee, I move that the board approve the report of the September 25th, 2014 meeting of the Committee on Personnel and Compensation. And are there any questions or any other discussion on this report?
Hearing none, I think we need a second.
Second.
Thank you, Regent Stites. Any further discussion?
And this report requires a roll call vote.
Thank you. Madam Secretary.
Regent Griscom.
Aye.
Regent Johnson.
Aye.
Regent Markham.
Aye.
Regent Prescott.
Aye.
Regent Reeves.
Aye.
Regent Reynolds.
Aye.
Regent Roddy.
Aye.
Regent Shockey.
Aye.
Regent Smith.
Aye.
Regent Stites.
Aye.
Regent Varlin.
Aye.
Regent Webb.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you. Regent Duckett's real job called him away from us this morning, which we all understand and appreciate. Chancellor, would you present the Finance Committee minutes?
Sure,
please?
Madam Chair. Thank you. I think, as you all know, the Finance and Business Operations Committee met yesterday in a regular session. The committee reviewed and recommended approval of the following items. One was the two consent item agendas. Second item was the capital budget recommendations for fiscal year 2015-16, which include $100,250,000 for capital outlay and $94,430,000 for capital maintenance. Also approved two new policies, budget principles, and institutional financial performance. Approved a revised information technology resources policy, and approved the system budget request for submission to TEHEC for fiscal year 2015-16. Madam Chair, I would recommend approval of the minutes.
Thank you. We need a motion from, thank you, Regent Griscom, and a second.
Second.
Thank you, Regent Roddy. Any discussion on finance and business ops minutes? Hearing none, as the Chancellor said, we do need a roll call vote. Mary?
Regent Griscom?
Aye.
Regent Johnson?
Aye.
Regent Markham?
Aye.
Regent Prescott?
Aye.
Regent Reeves?
Aye.
Regent Reynolds?
Aye.
Regent Roddy?
Aye.
Regent Shockey?
Aye.
Regent Smith?
Aye.
Regent Stites?
Aye.
Regent Varland?
Aye.
Regent Webb?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you very much. Dispensing with our business there. As Dwight Murphy just said, he and his colleagues will miss very much the services of these next two individuals, as will we. Both have done an outstanding job in their respective roles at Crossville and Dixon. And Regent Varland, as chairman of our TCAT committee, would you take us through our resolutions for these two great Tennesseans?
I am pleased to do so. The first one will be for Don Sadler, who has been the director of the Tennessee College of Applied Technology at Crossville. And I had the privilege of being in Crossville for his last graduation, which was just delightful, and he will be greatly missed. So whereas Mr. Don Sadler has faithfully served the college, Tennessee College of Applied Technology, Crossville, as director since 2008, and whereas he is a native of Tennessee and graduate of Tennessee Technological University with a bachelor's degree in secondary education, industrial arts in 1977, a master's degree in secondary administration and supervision in 1987, and a degree in educational administration and supervision in 1993. And whereas he served in the United States Army from 1971 to 1973, taught industrial arts for the Putnam County Board of Education from 1978 to 1981, worked on the Alaska Pipeline in Prudhoe Bay, Alaska, from 1981 to 1986, taught technology education for the Overton County Board of Education from 1987 through 1992, served as Director of Career and Technical Education for the Putnam County Board of Education from 1992 to 2008, and began his career in the Tennessee Board of Regents Systems with his appointment as director of the now Tennessee College of Applied Technology at Crossville on February 1st, 2008, and served until September 10th, 2014, providing over 30 years of service in the field of education in Tennessee. And whereas he is a member of the Crossville Noon Rotary and Greater Cumberland County Chamber of Commerce, a former member of the Cookeville Noon Rotary and Putnam County Chamber of Commerce, the Upper Cumberland Vocational Directors Study Council, Northern Central Tennessee Tech Prep Consortium, Cookeville Toastmasters Club, Tennessee Directors of Career and Technical Education, Tennessee Association for Career and Technical Education, and the Tennessee Central Railroad Spring Fest, and was recipient of the 2003-2004 Tennessee Association for Career and Technical Education's Vocational Administrator of the Year, and the finalist for the 2007 Tennessee Department of Education Supervisor of the Year Award. And whereas he was instrumental in developing the hybrid electric vehicle program at the Tennessee College of Applied Technology Crossville, which is the first in its state, in the state of Tennessee, and whereas he was instrumental in developing the participation agreement with the Tennessee Valley Authority for the solar panel project at the Tennessee College of Applied Technology Crossville, and whereas he shall be missed by community leaders, colleagues, faculty, staff, students, and alumni of the Tennessee College of Applied Technology Crossville, as well as friends within the TBR system. Now, therefore, let it be resolved that the members of the Tennessee Board of Regents wish to recognize the outstanding career of Mr. Don Sadler and express appreciation for his superb leadership.
Thank you.
Don,
as you make Don your way Medina. Down.
Yes.
All right, so that's your resolution in the form yes. of a motion. I always forget this part. I still need a second.
Second.
A unanimous second. Second from Regent Markham. This requires a voice vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Hear, hear.
Yes. Don.
Yes.
Regent Reynolds, Chancellor Morgan, Regent Markham, Honorable Regents, thank you. Thank you for your vote. Appreciate that. And thank you for those very kind words regarding my retirement, the resolution, and the recognition. I really appreciate that. It's a wonderful thing to be able to finish your career in your dream job. And that's what this has been for me for the last 6.5 years. What a wonderful spot in the world that TCAT Crossville is. What a wonderful spot in the world that Crossville and Cumberland County is. But to be a part of the TCAT system and to be at that school has just been absolutely wonderful for the last 6.5 years. It was a great school when I got there. And that's because of the leadership that ensued with Burton Ingram being the first director back in the late 60s, Jim Purcell after that, and Jerry Young was the interim director when I took over there. And the leadership there, they set the standards, and the standards have remained high, and I've had the support of the faculty and staff, one of the best in the state, just a wonderful faculty and staff. I couldn't ask for any better. And they have maintained the standards and provided the kind of quality education that we have come to expect from the TCATs. I've left it in good hands. Mr. Young has now become the interim there, and I feel very good about that and the way it has been handed off, so to speak. I also want to thank the Tennessee Board of Regents for your support in helping us accomplish our mission, which is to be the number one provider of workforce development and training in Tennessee. I also want to thank very much James King and his staff at the TCAT Central Office, Lynn Goodman, Carol Pereira, Carol Tomlinson, Shelley Travis, Bob Wallace, Sheila Dykes, Leanne Blevins, and I know I'm leaving out a few, but those folks have also been instrumental and paramount in their support in helping us accomplish our mission. Before I came to TCAT Crossville, I had 23 years in vocational technical education. I taught shop, as was mentioned, in All Good, after having received my degree in industrial arts. Early on, back in high school, my dad was a plumber and electrician. And he would wait until we got to a particularly nasty job. I used to be his helper. And I'd crawl out from under a floor somewhere, be in a ditch digging, or crawl out from some hot attic. And he was old school. You know, he would say, "Now, son, you need to go to school and get you an education where you won't have to do this kind of work," meaning digging ditches and so forth. So, but my mother was a teacher for 30 years, taught, and I'm not so sure she was as enamored about my abilities as my dad. And she'd tell me, "Now, son, you need to get a job working with your hands." So, so I guess I came about it honest. I went into industrial arts education. I wanted to be a shop teacher and teach kids how to work with their hands. And over the years, I've found that this has been a great career. Teaching in itself is an extremely rewarding career. The difference in a TCAT teacher and a first grade teacher is that we get to see a little bit sooner the results of our work. For a first grade teacher has to wait, you know, 12 or 15 years before they see that. So we get to see it a little bit. But it's always great when those students want to come back and they want you to know that you have made a difference in their lives. And I hope that I have made a difference in the lives of those that I've served over the years. So once again, I want to say thank you to the Tennessee Board of Regents, the TCAT Central Office, and for your support. Thank you.
Thank you, Jerry. Thank you, Dawn. Don, I think you can rest assured that you have made a very big difference in more lives than you may realize. Thank you for your service. Thank you. Regent Varlin, we will now honor Mark Powers.
Is Mark here?
Mm-hmm.
Good. Okay. Whereas, Mr. Mark Powers, has faithfully served the Tennessee College of Applied Technology Dixon as director since 2008. And whereas he is a native of Tennessee and graduated from Middle Tennessee State University in 1973 with a BS degree, but from the Massey School at Belmont University in 1996 with a Master's of Business Administration degree, and is a graduate of the Tennessee Law Enforcement Training Academy. And whereas he serves as the director of the Tennessee College of Applied Technology Harriman from 2001 to 2008, and served at Volunteer State Community College from 1995 to 2001 as director of the Business and Industry Institute, providing 19 years of service to the Tennessee Board of Regents system. And whereas he was instrumental in establishing a satellite facility in Ashland City to meet the growing need in outlying areas by creating relationships and partnerships with area hospitals, school systems, and industries. He created a solar photovoltaic program, to meet the demand for quality, trained individuals in this new area of technology, and he was instrumental in building of a $16 million expansion campus in Clarksville to expand TCAT course offerings in the Clarksville community. And whereas he was instrumental in promoting the legislation that changed the names of the Tennessee Technology Centers to the Tennessee Colleges of Applied Technology, and whereas he has served in numerous leadership roles within the Tennessee Board of Regents to include the TBR ROCE Curriculum Committee, the TCAT Director's Executive Sub-Council from 2003 to 2005 and from 2009 to 2011, Chair for the TCAT Diesel-Powered Equipment Technology Curriculum Committee, and Chair of the TCAT System Trimester Implementation Committee. And whereas he's a graduate of Leadership Roane County, Leadership Dixon County, and the East Tennessee Regional Leadership Class, served as City of Harriman City Councilman, was a certified Roane County Economic Developer, a fellow of the Tennessee Collaborative Leadership Academy, a member of the American Technical Education Association, a board member of the North Tennessee Workforce Board, and a member of the Regional Governance Board of the Middle Tennessee Regional Workforce Alliance, which has developed skills panels to align educational institutions and Tennessee's workforce to meet the workforce needs of Middle Tennessee. And whereas he shall be missed by community leaders, colleagues, faculty, staff, students, and alumni of the Tennessee College of Applied Technology Dixon, as well as friends within the TBR system, and now therefore let it be resolved that the members of the Tennessee Board of Regents wish to recognize the outstanding career of Mr. Mark Powers and express appreciation for his superb leadership.
Mark, as you make your way down, I will ask Regent Markham for a second.
Second.
Thank you very much. Oh, and all in favor?
Aye.
Very good. Mark Powers, those grandchildren are just too much of an appeal, right?
I know.
More time with them at the top of the list is what you told me.
That's true. I've got, I've got four, nine, seven, soon to be three in 6 months.
Oh, wow. That's
and
great.
I have my health today. So that's why I left. I'm going to enjoy my grandchildren while I can and spend some time with them. You've had me for a few years. I've done a few things. I didn't know I'd done all that. I guess when you're in the middle of it and involved, you don't think about all of that. But it's funny how things come around in circles. 2001 on this stage, you voted me in as a director. I believe Dr. Rota was the only person sitting up here that was sitting on the board at that time. Thanks. Appreciate your comment. I hope I've...
You did great.
Okay, thank you. Hey, I can leave now. Feeling good. He put me in and he said I was good leaving. Maybe it's good that I am leaving. Maybe, I don't know. But thank you for the opportunity. Thank you for the privilege. It's been my honor to serve this board, but more importantly, to serve the citizens of Tennessee. I've seen lives changed. And you've been, both of you have been in a graduation that we've had. And when we have the students come across, if you want to shake a sweaty palm, you need to get a hold of one of the biggest, brawniest guys that walks across the stage. It's just come out of a diesel program or welding program, and he's got a cap and gown, and his work boots are showing out from underneath that gown. And by the time he makes it across the stage to take your hand to receive his diploma, buddy, he has really, I hope he got, he's almost dehydrated because I think most of it's right there in the palm of his hand. It's a great, that is a great feeling. Let me tell you, it's great because his life or her life, whoever those students are forever changed. They're forever changed by what they did and what we were able to provide as a system and as a school. That's what it's all about. That's why we're here, to build a greater state, a better economy, a better country, one person at a time. Thank you. Don named all the people. I'm not going to try to do that. I'll leave somebody out. But I do appreciate your support, your trust in me over these years. I've tried my very best. I've done my very best. And now I'm going to spend it with my wife and grandkids. Thank you.
Enjoy that time with your family, but know that you will always be part of our extended family at the Tennessee Board of Regents. I think both of those great tributes reminded me of that fabulous young woman we saw in the video this morning who spoke at her graduation and talked about having faith in people and what we can accomplish. So that was, both of you, very moving, and we are honored to know you, so thank you. We are right at adjournment time. We have a few announcements. A most important, December 11, we will see you at the central office for our final meeting of 2014. Chancellor Morgan, you have any further announcements, my friend?
Very briefly, Madam Chair, I would just like to, I didn't get a chance to do this last night at the event, but would like very much to extend my sincere thanks and appreciation to Anthony and his team for hosting us, but particularly Tom Gaddis, who runs the Culinary Arts Program. I think it was fantastic, incredible is the best word, dinner, as well as Bill Brewer and the variations. When you think about that group was there, they've been here 5 weeks, about half of those students were first-time freshmen, and to hear them perform the way they did was, for me, really incredible. I used to try to do that kind of thing when I was in college. And I also, just as a final comment, would like very much to thank Sanja Mason, Pat Massey, Carol Tomlinson, and Matthew Gann for once again putting things together and handling the logistics of what has been a very, very successful meeting. So thank you.
Thank you.
That's it.
Anything else? Dr. Wise, one more time to thank you, but I'd like for you to come back with any closing comments for us.
Just a couple of things that I would like to note. One, as the Chancellor mentioned, we do have a great team here at Pellissippi State, and we had a big team effort to pull this off. We're so glad you were on campus with us for the last couple of days. You're welcome back anytime. I hope it won't be until the next meeting, which I think is pretty far out in the future. We have a great team. We had two individuals on campus who worked particularly hard over the last 6 months, and I would like to recognize them for their great work. The college works a lot better when I'm away than it does when they're away. But Ann Burgess and Joanne Monholland in my office have worked on this and worried about this for months. So I just want to give them a public recognition for how much I appreciate the great work they did in pulling our team together and pulling this event off. So, Ann and Joanne.
Thank you. Thank you both. Well-deserved
way
comments.
To go.
Beautiful flowers.
All right, and then I think the last thing I have to say is the box lunch is in the lobby, and have a safe trip home.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Haven't fed us well enough this week. Thank you again. This was a swell time. Anybody have any further announcements, comments? Now, we have an assignment, gang. We've had a great discussion today. But before you leave here on your iPad or when you get home, tie that little string around your finger. TennessePromise.gov. TennesseeAchieves.org. We need to sign up to be mentors. On that note, safe travels and thank you.
Thank you. Good job.
Oh, thank you.
Well done.
Thank you.
Good meeting.